Hi everyone, thank you for joining this webinar and I'm very welcome. So I would like to welcome you to this Impact EdTech webinar. Today we will talk about EdTech private investments. And I'm very happy to welcome today Marie-Christine Levet. She's a French internet pioneer with 23 years of experience in new technology. And she's the founder of EduCapital. It's the first European fund dedicated to EdTech. And I am Lucy Milcent. I'm a project manager in Funding Box. So I will moderate this webinar and take care of the logistics. And before I give the floor to Marie-Christine, I would like to present you quickly the European project Impact EdTech. It's a partnership of three partners. It's coordinated by European SchoolNet, their network of European ministries of education. And we have also our partner ISDE Accelerator. They're a specialist in acceleration methodologies for startups. And I'm from Funding Box, and we are specialized in open call management and cascade funding for SMEs. So I don't know if you have seen already on our website, but in this European project, we will help 42 startups to bring their digital education innovation to the market. So we are targeting early stage startups with a promising prototype. And there will be funding and mentoring during a 9-month hybrid incubation and acceleration program, which will help you to define your MVP and bring it to the market. So right now we have our open call that is still open until the 30th of June. So if you're interested to apply, I would advise you to visit our website impactedtech.eu. You have all the information there. We also did a specific webinar on the open call, which is uploaded already on the website, so you can have a look. And on the 15th of June, we will have another Q&A specifically about the open call, how to apply, who is it for, the amount of funding, how to get selected, etc., etc. So that was just a short introduction, and now we'll leave the floor to our speaker today, Marie-Christine.
Hello everybody. So I plan today to give you some views of EdTech in the world, and then go into some specific advice about how to raise money for an EdTech project. So if you look at the 17 Sustainable Development Goals of the OECD, education is the fourth one with quality education, and really we need more and more education in the world. We see the economy as a knowledge economy today. We were in an industrial economy at one point with key was the production of goods. Then we shift to a post-industrial economy at the beginning of the internet with the service economy, and now we are in a knowledge economy where human capital is key and education is key. We think that there's a necessary transformation of education, and the answer to that is the innovation. And for some reason, first, education is right now too inaccessible. There are 260 million children in the world that do not have access to schools. It's a very unequal system. 750 million children cannot read and write, and education is very costly for the planet, with $129 billion per year, the cost of the world crisis of learning. Answer is innovation. We need to transform our education systems all around the world. We need to educate the planet. There will be 1 billion new students by 2035. If we need universities, we need to build one university per week in the world. So we see that we cannot cope with the amount of new learners with traditional education system, and we need to innovate and we need to implement online learning. The second point is that the job market is changing. 50% of the jobs will radically change by 2030. There's a common number that 35% of children right now in schools will do jobs that even do not exist. And you know, the diploma that in the past once everybody had for its life, it's finished. You know, we really need to retrain people all their life. You know, people will have, you know, the diploma and perhaps, you know, 10 micro certification all their long lives. And you know, there's a really, really strong important momentum of upskilling people in organizations. And and it's true that we have to adapt also to new usage. You know, today 70% of the Generation Z think that YouTube is their first mean to get knowledge. If you look at EdTech, you know, what is the definition of EdTech? We understand EdTech as education technology, so everything that brings innovation to the education area. It could be an innovation of usage or a technological innovation. And we go from childhood up to lifelong learning. You see the different clients or customers. It could be the parents and the schools, then the corporation, then the learner. And we cover, you know, the early childhood, K-12, with the children from 12 to 18, then higher education, corporate training, that means training inside the corporation, and lifelong learning, that means, you know, training that one individual does for himself, you know, to and mainly to increase its employability. If you look at the EdTech market, you know, there's a huge opportunity in this market, and we will see that it has been completely increased by the COVID crisis. The education market in itself, it's a $6.5 trillion market in the world, and we estimate that today it's only digitalized around by 2.5%. If you compare to other industries, like for example the media industry is digitalized by 35 to 40%. Retail industry is digitalized by 15%. So education, digitalization of the education market has was lagging behind, and we estimate that even if we gain 2 points, you know, in this digitalization, the tech market would have a potential of $342 billion. So it's a really untapped market in terms of digitalization, and we will see that the COVID crisis has really made the world, the whole world, enter into EdTech, and will increase strongly this digitalization. If you look at the EdTech market in the world, this is the picture of all the investment that has been made in this area in the last 3 years. You know, last year there's been $7 billion invested in EdTech. A year before it was $8.3 billion. We see that the US and China are really dominating this market. They account for 2/3 of the global investment. But for the first time in 2019, Europe has reached the threshold of $1 billion investment and has the fastest growth. If you look at the different countries and where do they invest, in China, you know, there's a huge investment in the K-12 area. Chinese invest a lot for their children. It's mainly for their only child. You see that K-12 represents 64% of the investment. There's been huge investment and huge deals in China. You know, average fundraising amount is over $30 million. And there are, and if you look at the top three fundraise in China, you know, they amount over, they are between 200 and 400 million dollars. So it's a tutoring platform, it's a Q&A social network, and it's an English education platform. There are unicorns now in China, and that's also one of the reasons why China education has been the least impacted by the COVID crisis, because and the Chinese children had their nearly normal schools at all. If you look at the US has continuously invested in EdTech in the last years. It has invested in all areas, you know, from K-12 to corporate learning and lifelong learning. And in terms of you know, biggest raise, you know, the biggest raise in the US, has been Coursera with $100 million raised for online courses, BetterHelp and Grammarly. And it's higher ed and continuous education has received a lot of fundings in the US. If you look at Europe, which interests all of us, because it's really booming. We think that for the first time last year, Europe has exceeded 1 billion investment. We can see that European investment have mainly gone towards continuous education, meaning lifelong learning and corporate training. There's been around nearly 100 deals done in Europe in terms of investment in 2019. An average fundraising amount was $11 million. The three companies who raised the most money are JobTeaser. It's a recruitment platform for higher ed, Graduate, an alumni network in the UK, and FutureLearn online courses. So higher ed and lifelong learning has been the two pillars of investment in Europe. And we will see that COVID will have an impact on the areas and categories, you know, where EdTech is investing the most. If you look at the global market, we have now unicorns in EdTech. That means companies that are valued more than 1 billion. There are companies that have gone in IPO, like Chegg, Pluralsight in the US, 2U, and there are a lot of companies that have really raised a lot of money and that have passed this threshold valuation of 1 billion. They are mainly in the US and in China. Interesting to see that we have the first first European company that has been public into EdTech. It's Kahoot. It's a Danish company. What is interesting to see is the time that it has taken all these companies to become unicorns. It has gone very, very fast, you know. Like, for example, if you see Guild Education is a recent company in the US. They provide online education for blue collars, and it took 4 years to Guild to become a unicorn. In China, like VIP Kid, who provides English lesson to Chinese children, or Zuye Bong, who provides also online education to children, have become unicorns in 72-80 months. So it's going very, very fast. What is the impact of COVID? In less than days, you know, 1.2 billion children and young people have been unable to attend school and universities. Up to 150 countries have closed their school. This has had an enormous impact on EdTech. You know, everybody has discovered EdTech. We think that this crisis has really put down a lot of psychological barriers that people had in mind, you know, regarding online education, and it will have huge impact on the world of education, in the world of in the future of work, mainly regarding lifelong learning and higher ed. By 2024, a lot of people estimate that 30% of graduate students in the US will take fully online courses. We've seen huge explosion during this period on traffic on EdTech platforms. In our portfolio, most of our companies, you know, have had an increase of their traffic from 200%. You know, there's been a huge you know, demand from parents, you know, to try online learning. So if you look at the market, it's very interesting to see that EdTech companies have outperformed the market. If you look at Kahoot, which is this company, Danish company that's been the first IPO in EdTech, you know, Kahoot provides, you know, a platform for teachers to implement game. And they also bought different companies. They bought a company called DragonBots, which provides, you know, math learning platform. very gamified. And the Chegg, which is a very, very interesting US company, they have outperformed the market and outperformed the Nasdaq. If you look at the market potential before and post COVID, we think that before COVID, you know, the two areas that then, I'm speaking about Europe, the China so is very different. But in Europe, the two areas that were that benefit from the most investments in EdTech and who also had the biggest growth were corporate training and lifelong learning. To give you some example, lifelong learning, very interesting company in France called Open Classroom. They provide online classes in a lot of areas, mainly digital areas, and they raised $60 million from a US fund. Corporate training, a lot of companies in France with 360 Learning, Corp Academy, they provide corporate learning platforms for companies. These were the two main areas of focus of mostly all VC, and these were also where companies had the biggest growth and where the market was also the bigger. We think that due to COVID, there will be perhaps a shift of behavior and mentalities, and K-12 B2B higher ed and the K-12 B2C will benefit from this the COVID crisis. K-12 B2B and higher ed mainly because governments and schools have realized that they were not ready at all to provide online education and education at home, and mainly during the last 3 months in most European countries there's been what we call in France system day, that people are teachers have tried to use tools but they were not trained, they didn't have the right tools to teach children online and teach them at home. So there will be investment from most of the governments in these areas. In terms of for the university, a lot of universities will not open in traditional way in September, so there will be also huge investments to offset this the fact that they were behind in terms of digitalization. And in terms of parents, what I call K-12 B2C, that means parents buying online tools for their children to help them learn math or learn languages. There will be also a different shift in mentality, and we think that these three areas could represent a big potential for the years to come. So you see that EdTech becomes to begin an attractive market for VCs for three main reasons. There are unicorns in this area. We saw 2U, Udacity, Udemy, VIP Kids are companies that have reached this 1 billion valuation. There's a very dynamic M&A activity in EdTech, mainly in the US for the moment. There's been nearly 150 M&A operations in 2018, and 52% of acquired companies have been created less than 10 years. And they are promising European company. I spoke about Open Classroom, lifelong learning platform, 360 learning, platform for corporate learning, Kahoot in Denmark for teachers, to provide them platform to create games. And Labster, very interesting, also a Danish company who provides virtual laboratories for K-12 and for higher ed to learn sciences. In a much more gamified way. So EduCapital that we created 2 years and a half ago is the first European investment platform for education. There are plenty of funds like EduCapital in the US, but there was no fund yet in Europe. So our thesis is the fact that there's a booming tech industry worldwide, mainly in US and China. And in this post-COVID context, Europe has to do EdTech and has to also offset the fact that they were lagging behind. And we have a unique opportunity to build European leaders in this area. So we are only dedicated to EdTech and also future of work, and we target EdTech in all its value chain, you know, from little childhood up to corporate training and lifelong learning. We have a European scope. We have $50 million fund, and we invest mainly in Series A. We invest mainly in companies that have already a product, a proof of concept, and already revenues. And we target 20 companies in our portfolio. If you look at our portfolio, you know, we have already for the moment 14 companies. We go from little childhood up to lifelong learning. First year of operation, we have mainly invested in France because we're based in France. And the second year, we have invested in different European countries. So we are, to give you an example, we are investors of Looney. Looney is a little radio for very small children. It develops creativity of the children. There's a store where children can download their stories and they can choose their stories, the characters, the settings, and it's a tool without screen for small children. Then we invest in Lalilo for the K-12 area. Lalilo is an adaptive learning platform to teach reading for the really small children, first year of schools. Lalilo is between the France and the US. Lalilo has had huge increase due to COVID. We invest in higher ed in different, a lot of companies in the higher ed areas. I spoke to you about Labster, you know, in Denmark. Labster is a Danish company. They provide for all Danish college students, you know, these virtual laboratories to learn science, chemistry, and physics. And they're also big and expanding in the US. We invest in the corporate training area. Learning is a platform for corporate learning, and we invest in the lifelong learning. We just did during the COVID investment in Preply. Preply is a company between Spain and Ukraine, and they have developed a platform for language learning where they connect learners with teachers all around the world, and they also had a huge increase of traffic and the revenues during this COVID period. So I tried to map, you know, some main trends that we see in EdTech. So the first trend is this pedagogy 3.0, is the fact that the school now is out of the wall, and everybody has experienced that during COVID. Is the reverse class, 100% online, where learners, you know, do all classes, you know, through virtual classes, and they go to physical schools to have practical application of what they study and to develop creativity, collaboration. There's a very interesting schools in the US called Minerva. Minerva is really the example of this reverse class and this new pedagogy. It's now three times more difficult to enter Minerva than Harvard. They have no schools, no physical schools, but they are they have students, you know, that are gathering together, and they are active in and they go to seven countries, you know, during 4 years. One interesting trend that we believe a lot is the personalized learning and adaptive learning is the use of data and analytics to provide personalized learning and we think that this is one of the main impact of EdTech. EdTech will really help people to be able to have a personalized, you know, education, and this personalized education can reduce, you know, dropout by 50%. A second very important trend in EdTech is peer-to-peer learning. It's a much more, you know, active learning. You learn by peer. You know, There's a very interesting school in France called 42. 42 is the school you know, to learn coding during 2 years. It's without teacher and students learn only by project and by peer-to-peer learning. 360 learning, you know, as a platform is also into this peer-to-peer learning where there's no coach and you learn with your colleagues. And everybody can create a content to teach its college. One other trend which is very important in EdTech is gamified education. So use of gaming tactics, use of virtual reality to have a much more rewarding, playful and engaging education. A very interesting company called DragonBot that has been bought by Kahoot was providing really gamified education to their math. Kano is a UK company where you can build your own computer and it's a computer to also teach children how to learn code. Another trend in EdTech is immersive learning. We spoke about Labster, you know, provide these virtual laboratories. You know, use of virtual reality will be a key trend with the democratization of the headset. We estimate that 60% of American schools will use it in the 5 years to come. And AR VR market would be a market of $215 billion. And the usage with education is very important because it really enables people to get much more engaged. So I think you know it's interesting if we can have a discussion on this topic because I think this is something that may interest a lot of you. I put some of the criteria about how to raise money you know, for an EdTech startup. And what our business angels and VC and the funds and accelerators are looking for. The first thing is the team. It's very important to have a diverse and complementary co-founder teams that are 100% active in the project. You know, most of the VCs don't like teams where like people are doing this project as a side project. You know, they need people committed in this project. It's very, I could be careful of the one-man show. We tend to like teams that have complementary skills. You know, ideally, it will be to have business skills, tech skills, and pedagogical skills, at least two of the three, but very important to have a complementary founder team. Then for, I speak about VC, and I speak about, it's important to have a product ready. We don't invest on PowerPoint. We invest on products that have users, and we invest on products that have already their proof of concept. So, what is the proof of concept for B2B product? It means product that you sell to schools or to corporation. It's important to have schools or corporation using your product, having implemented pilot, and it's important to prove that the your customer that the product is scalable. That means that you can you know, begin by a pilot and then increase it. You start with one class and you increase it to the whole school, or you start with a department and company and increase the whole corporation. That's very important to prove that you know the product answers the needs and it's scalable in its customer. For B2C, main important thing is usage. A good B2C product gets usage, so it's very important that you know your metrics of usage, how many times a child you know connect to the platform, how many week, how many minutes that it stays on the platform, how does it do, and know very well your metrics. Figures like the CAC, you know, acquisition cost, the ARPU, you know, how many, for example, if it's a premium product, what's the percentage of conversion between the free product and the paid product, how much people pay per month for this product, what's the churn rate if you go into subscription model, the metrics, knowing your metrics, following your metrics is key, and mainly following the metrics usage. I've never seen a good product, a product succeeding without good metrics usage. And then in terms of financing, I think at the beginning, it's very important to explore all states, European Union health, all competition, like the one we are seeing today, also all debt, you know, a lot of countries, you know, help startups to launch a project with you know, some very good to take, you know, loans. And for most of the Series A funds, when they look at the EdTech product, they require revenue. So I put a bracket because, you know, nothing is really straight, but it's a bracket between 300k euro and 1 million euro on annual recurring revenue. And mean that you are in the trend to do these revenues. So these are the main criteria I see, you know, to be able to raise money for an EdTech startup. But I think that we are in this EdTech world, we are in a very good position because we are sitting in a huge market, a very resilient market. We need education. And a market that has not entered in its digitalization phase, but has been, you know, but this crisis has really increased the speed in which this market will digitize in the years to come. So it's a very good market to be right now, and I hope, you know, you all will succeed with your project, and I'm happy to answer any question you might have.
Thank you so much, Marie-Christine. It's very insightful. Yes, so for all the participants, you can use the questions tab on the GoToWebinar dashboard, and I will assign all of them to Marie-Christine. So we have already received a few questions, which I will read now. The first one is, can you elaborate on what do you mean by product ready? And before letting Marie-Christine answer this, I would like to clarify that in our project, we are selecting companies that do not yet have their MVP tested in operational environment, indoor environment. So yes, that's the difference between our project and the VC private funding that Marie-Christine is offering. So yes, I will let her answer on to elaborate on what does she mean by product ready.
Yes, the criteria I have put on the slide is mainly criteria for VC, you know, for like when you go to raise money in towards fund. It's not, you know, product that criteria you need for competition like the one, you know, with the European Union. That's why I was saying at the first time when you are on this MVP, better to use the money from all this competition or from loans, from governments, etc., or business angels. When you go to see a VC, the product really means that you go out of the MVP and you have already user. It can be, you know, pilot that are, you know, for example, in schools, you have different schools that have already used your product as pilot, and you have some of them that have been able to scale the pilot. So it's important to have like POC, it's pilot or POC, you know, anyway, and that have, and inside this pilot, because we all know that you would start by pilot, you know, never one corporation will take you for the whole entire corporation, neither government, neither, you know, group of schools. So you start with pilot. It's important to prove that some pilots have converted into bigger projects. And product ready means that the product is really ready to use by individuals or teachers, or and that it's fully operational. Even if we know that in the web we have different versions of product, and you can have the first version of the product ready, and then we able to implement new features in the versions to be ready in the future, but at least that the first version of the product is ready. So I'm looking at different questions. Do you also invest outside Europe? We mainly focus in Europe and Israel. We can invest a bit outside Europe. But as we are, we think that it's important, you know, investment in many in early company, in early stage companies to be near. It's a really a question of being near the entrepreneurs and being able to help them and give them support. That's why we are not investing very far away from our home base. We can do co-investment outside, you know, in different countries, but between many local funds. What are the product criteria for seed investment? I think I answered this question. Do you invest with your own portfolio as business angel in a prior stage? We are mainly a Series A fund where we can invest in an earlier stage product. For example, when we invest in Lalilo, Lalilo is an adaptive learning platform for schools. They didn't have revenue, so it was a bit of an exception regarding, you know, our trends, but they had the product was used in a lot of schools. So we can invest in earlier stage if we have a good usage metrics. Okay, I looked at the different the criteria regarding the actual or targeted geographical footprint. I'll read the questions. What are the criteria regarding the actual or targeted geographical footprint of the company you invest in? I think that when you start a company, it's good to be to start with your own country. And if you have good figures if you're on a country, it's already a good start. It's true that if you can be international from day one, it's better, but you know, it depends what you do. If you do a B2C product, like for example an app, you can have an international strategy from day one. But if you do B2B, mainly selling to schools or selling to corporation, it's very difficult to be international for day one. And I often advise that you start with your own country, which is often easier, and then you could and if you have shown to a VC that you're good in your own country, you don't need to be in other countries. You know, it really depends on the product, but it's very difficult for a B2B product to be able to be in different countries at the beginning. It's different for B2C because you're on the web or on the app stores, and you can at the beginning target an international product. Is the UK being in the, yes, because we were created before Brexit, so UK for us is in was in Europe, so we invest in the UK. We already did an investment in UK. We invest in a company called Makers Academy. It's a school. It's a bootcamp school to teach code, and it also have a lot of B2B customers that want to upskill their employees and giving them some digital and coding skills. How to get in touch? I think I put in the last slide, you know, our contacts. You can send me a mail, or you can also, the best is to use, we have a form in our website where you can enter directly your company's, what company is doing, you know, you can attach documents. I think the best to use our form on our website. Very interesting question. What do you say would be an underrated characteristic or skill for the edtech founders? I have the impression that the thing that is really that you need, that is a requirement, is to have good technical skills, because the product that doesn't work never wins. But I think that often EdTech founders do not have pedagogical skills. And for example, if you sell a product to teachers, it's very good that you have a teacher in the team, or somebody who has been a teacher in the team, or you work with teachers. And so it's I think that the underrated skill is often the pedagogical one. Do you have a view on the African market potential? I think there's a huge potential in Africa because it's a bit like in e-commerce, you know. Africa will go one step further. They will perhaps sometimes pass the presential schools, the traditional schools, and we go directly to online schools. We are not covering Africa because it's too far away from us. But I know a fund, there will be a fund, you know, that will be launched, I think, next year, that will be covered, that will cover Africa on education. It's a fund that will be launched by Investisseurs et Partenaires. It's a French fund that is a project to fund an African fund based in Abidjan, dedicated to EdTech. And I think there's huge potential in the higher ed, huge potential in lifelong learning for online platform, because Africa is lacking universities and it's lacking also teachers. Does Educate Capital provide additional service besides capital, like networking, coaching, expanding market abroad? Yes, this is our job. You know, we are dedicated funds, so we don't invest in thousands of companies. We select, we select 20 companies, and our role is to provide money, but mainly to provide support. So we want to be involved. We help companies, you know, structure their organization. We help them, help them recruit new persons. We help them on their business model. We see a lot of business models, so it helps us to see what works, what doesn't work. We help them on structuring their expansion internationally. So yeah, it's a much, and we help them also for business developments, you know, introducing them to customers, to schools, to corporations. So it's we see our help as much profound than just financial. Financial is important, but I think and even if you look at business angel, I think it's very important for you to get smart money. Smart money, it's often better to get less smart money, but smart money values more than just traditional money. And if you look at business angel, try to find, you know, business angel that can help you a lot in networking, in coaching. I think it's very important. It's often perhaps more important to give perhaps a bit more equity to a business angel that will really help you and provide you a smart money than somebody that just wants to invest and doesn't care about helping the team. If a startup is applying for investment from your fund, you provide a lot of feedback to rejected application. Yes, and often, you know, relationship with funds doesn't apply from one day to the other. We often like to see a project, even if they don't need money, or even if they are at a stage where it's too early for us, and we like to follow a project. For example, most of the projects we have done, we knew the founders, you know, from years, you know, from like 2 years ago, and we've seen how they have advanced. And we meet them regularly, perhaps, you know, we have talked with them once a quarter, and we see how they make progress. And what is very important is that when somebody says, I will do that, and they have done it, you know, it's very important. This is how you build trust with an investor. So it's very important to, I think it's even better to have links with funds and, you know, investors, and when you are not raising money than when you are raising money. So the day you will raise money, you will be ready, you will have known them before, they know you, they have seen your progress, they have seen how you execute. So it's very important to have this relationship before. And it's often, you know, it's you know, when you choose a fund, it's often for a long period. It's nearly like a wedding. You know, you choose a fund for like 5 years, 6, 7 years, could even 10 years. So it's very important that you build this trust even before you you raise the money with the fund. Could you share some example of the kind of support that you have provided as an investor in a company? Or like, you know, if I look at, you know, 360 learning, corporate platform for corporate learning, you know, we have introduced them a lot to different customers. We have challenged them with the business plan. We have helped them recruit some of the key people in the team. If we did help a lot on recruitment, structuring the company, you know, biz dev opportunities, you know, meeting customers, and also you know, if they look at companies to acquire or to help them to review companies, and so we often have you know, weekly calls with our startup CEOs. How does Edit Capital bring differentiated added value to its portfolio companies compared with another VC? You know, so in terms of education, we are specialized in education. So we see a lot of projects in this area. So I think we know this area very, very well. So really, some of the VCs can also provide very good support. We often like sometimes to invest with other VCs. It's often good to have two VCs because they can provide a different, you know, helps. But at least in education, we know a lot of models, and we also speak with a lot of US funds, so we can also help them, you know, raise the future money, you know, if they want to expand in the US. And the international Latin Americas, we don't invest. You know, the two areas where we don't invest are Africa and Latin America. We know there are huge potential, but we are very, very far away, and we think that we do not provide the adequate support to companies when we are so far away. So Australia, Latin America, Africa, we don't invest. We tend to stick to Europe, having UK, having Israel, and we can do some co-investment in the US with other funds. But for the other areas, it's very difficult to be able to provide the adequate support being so far. You think teachers in France, Italy are ready to use apps like Lailo? That's a very, very interesting question. I think the crisis, as this COVID crisis, has shown us that there's a big, big difference between teachers. Some teachers are really online ready and they can use a platform, but some others are really not ready. And I think that one of the main important things that government should do in many Latin European countries will be to train teachers. Teachers have not been trained to EdTech, and so we think that training teachers, EdTech will not succeed in schools if teachers are not trained. And I personally believe that we should adapt in all this country what has been done in Nordic countries, like in Finland, for example, which is one of the top countries in all PISA ranking. It's very important to see that teachers are very free to use the tools they want. I don't think you force a teacher to use EdTech. I think you need to let teachers are one of the professions where you have the most freedom, and often people choose to be teacher to have this freedom. And I really believe that you should let people use the tool they want. Some teachers want to use paper, they should keep paper. The teachers that want to use digital should use digital, but I think you should stick to this freedom for the teacher to use the tool they want. And it's important that the teachers are trained to use EdTech. Yes, we will be interesting to go to the question is, do you welcome invitation to EdTech pitch events? With pleasure, you know, it depends, you know, for the moment, you know, I don't think we'll travel a lot in the next months to come, but we are very happy to attend to pitch events either, you know, online, and if we can, at one point we can travel and combine with, you know, trips to countries and see the tech communities. We are very happy to do it. Have you invested in B2C solutions? Yes, we have invested in a company, in two, three companies. We have invested in lifelong learning in B2C. We have invested in Live Mentor. Live Mentor is a platform to teach entrepreneurship. So customers are people that want, adults that want to change jobs, want to create their companies, and they subscribe to Live Mentor to get training for how to create a company, how to get known on the internet, how to do your business plan. And we also invest in Preply. Preply is an online platform for individuals to learn languages. And we invest in a company also called DigiSchool in France. It's a lot of apps for students to prepare their exams. For example, to prepare exams for coding, for writing, to prepare their baccalaureate, to prepare all their exams. So we have invested in, and we invest also in Luni. Luni is a B2C solutions for very small children, because it's a sort of a radio that you can buy either on the web or in traditional stores, and then you can download a lot of stores. It works like an app store, but it's the Luni own content, or content done with partners. We believe that in terms of B2C, before COVID, it was easier for adults, because adults can, you know, take themselves, you know, and they can control their time and their priorities, and they can stick to an online platform. Before COVID, there were parents who were quite reluctant to buy, you know, apps, you know, for their children, you know, thinking that children were spending too much time on their screens. And I think that COVID has really changed the thing. That that's why I said in my chart that B2C, I can show you the chart, you know, I mentioned that that B2C K-12 might be a big opportunity for the years to come post-COVID. It's this chart where you see that K-12 B2C, I think, will really increase its digitization and the potential of the market. If I look at other company, other questions, do you have any exit yet? No, not yet. You know, it takes time to have exit. Usually, when that's why I say, you know, choosing your fund or your investor is a very important decision. It can take up to 5 years, you know, to sell a company. You know, if you look at most of the companies that have really succeeded their exit, it often took them 10 years. The terms we sign with companies, we sign deals where we say that 5 years from the day we have done the investment, we sit together and see what can be the exit. But it often takes more than 2 years, you know, to build a good company. And how do you select the timing? I think timing, we have in the part, in the contract we have with company, we have this 5 year, you know, rule. But you know, timing is often due to opportunities. You know, it's true that we also try to help our companies to exit, you know, and have a relation with corporate. For example, a lot of our investors in our funds, you know, main investors are, you know, publishers that, you know, can also at one point, you know, be interested to buy some of our portfolio companies. Do you cooperate with ministries of education? Yes, we try to. It's often we do try to do a lot of lobbying, mainly in France, you know, where we tend to say to Minister of Education that it will be much better for them, you know, if they want to do edtech, to do that with private companies instead of building their own platform, because, you know, we often took the example of, you know, Airbnb has not been invented by Accor, or BlaBlaCar has not been invented by a main SNCF in France railway station, or, you know, and often innovation comes from much better companies that are smaller, that are much more agile, and that the way you need to work is to cooperate with these companies. So in France, we have helped a lot of our companies to get some fundings from the French government for, you know, that have launched, you know, a program of investments, you know, to help edtech companies. So we tend to cooperate as much as we can with the Ministry of Education, even if it's not easy because they are a huge organization and it's difficult to move. To add something to that, I think it's, when you sell to schools, it's very important to cooperate with the Minister of Education of your own countries. Does using white label products to build your own edtech platform impact seeking investment? Yes, it can impact. If it's an open source product that you take and that you build on, it's not that important, but if we tend to, for us, the technical platform is often a big asset, and if you don't have this asset, you know, it can be a drawback, and it can be an inconvenience in your project, because if at one point the company to which you license your product stops the licensing, you know what happens. So we tend to like companies that have built their own technological platform. We think that one of the main assets, you know, the three main assets of an edtech company is its team, its platform, and its customers. So if you're lacking one out of the three, it could be a disadvantage. How much is the capital team involved in the governance of the portfolio companies? I answer this question. We are involved because we are sitting in most of the company of our portfolio company board. And except if we invest a bit far away from our home countries, and that we are investing with a local co-investor, that is a local fund, and we can share the governance. But otherwise, we like to be in the board of the company. Trying about the public sector, do you know what are the best European countries to work public teaching institutions? And France is pretty hard, I agree with that. My impression is that the most open countries are Nordic countries, Denmark, Norway, Finland, Sweden, and that Latin America is lagging behind. I have the impression that the UK is quite open. In the UK, schools are ready to buy their own product. So I guess UK is also quite open, but Latin countries are less open. I think I've gone through. How do you explain that there are more investment in lifelong learning than in education? I explain that mainly to the fact that it's hard to work with the public education, and that most of the education is public in our European countries, and that it takes time to sell to schools, you know, even if so that's why B2Ed market was one of the most difficult, you know, area in edtech. And lifelong learning, you know, you sell to individuals. So, you know, individuals that when they are ready to spend money for their, and lifelong learning was often turn towards employability, and people, you know, I think more and more in the months and the years to come are ready to stand to increase the employability, mainly in countries where unemployment rates are quite high. I'm looking at the different questions. I think I've answered most of the questions.
Yes, I think all the questions are answered, and we're also running out of time. There's maybe one time for last question. What are your views on the peer learning market?
I think it's a very, very interesting market that has, and there are not that many projects yet in this area. That's been, I put it as one of the main trends that are very, very interesting.
Okay, yeah, I think all the questions have been answered. There was a few questions also about the Impact EdTech Acceleration Program, which I've answered privately by written answer. So thank you very much, Marie-Christine, for your presentation and for answering all the high number of questions from participants. If some of you haven't had their question answered about the acceleration program, there is an email contact. It's contact@impactedtech.eu. So you can contact us there and we will reply your doubts. As I said, we also did a webinar, which is available on the website about the open call, and we'll have a Q&A session on the 15th of June. And yes, as Marie-Christine explained, you can also contact her through the website that they have a specific form in which you can define your offer, your solution, and I will get back to you. So if your solution is a bit more advanced, I would advise you to contact her. And if you're a very early stage, the Impact EdTech Acceleration Program can be a good opportunity for you. So yes, thank you very much, Marie-Christine.
Thank you to everybody. Don't hesitate, you know, to follow us and also to subscribe to our newsletter so you have news about us. And if your project is ready, don't hesitate to fill the form. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye. Bye, everyone.